the morning and I ask myself, is life worth living? Should I blast myself? Oh yeah, welcome back, or welcome to another episode of The Real PLC. I don't know about y'all. But we here for some change, and we got a heavy hitter in the studio today.
Big time, man.
So shout out to Dr. Walker for putting us on to this interview. Dr. Walker, if you listen to this, thank you. Ladies and gentlemen, we're here with the brother behind the bristles, artist, entrepreneur, educator, Mr. Arshaad Norwood.
Yes.
Thank you.
All right. What's happening, y'all? Yeah. Hey, I appreciate y'all having me.
Thank you for agreeing to do this right after you just did the Black History program for us, man. Which the kids, I already told you, man. I went and talked to my kids, and they were ecstatic about the program. They were really, really happy and excited, man. And thank you.
That's dope. Appreciate it. Hey, no problem, man. Hey, that's what I do it for.
Heck yeah. So, once again, so just echoing, man, thank you so much, because. You know, hey, you took a day off, hit your spur of the moment. And so, thank you for taking time out of your day to come here and share a message. So we were talking before, and just kind of a little background on the podcast. It's just a chance for us to have a platform for educators to talk, to share their story, their message. And like we said, just kind of shed a human light on a profession where people forget at the end of the day, we're just human. And plus, I forgot my shot. This is the Real PLC, a meeting that shouldn't be an email, actually want to be here, and it's applicable to your everyday life.
I'm telling you.
Little shot, but we love it. All right, so first question right off the rip for you, put you right on the spot. Talk to us about young Arshaad. What was your childhood like?
Oh, man, if you're talking about heavy questions, that's a heavy question. Because if you're talking about my childhood, it's two different worlds I grew up in. Of course, my name is Arshaad. It's Arabic. My first language was Arabic. Wow. I grew up in a Muslim community in Philadelphia. So like I said, it was totally different than, I guess, the average, black upbringing. What I mean by that is we grew up in kind of like I said, a community, but boys lived separate than the girls. So lived in like separate cottages.
Okay.
So I grew up around all boys. So, you know what I'm saying? My sister, she stayed, with the girls. And I actually didn't live with my mom and dad. So, I mean, the dynamic was completely different than, right. I guess, the standard, black story.
Yeah.
So, but beyond that, of course, like I said, grew up in Philadelphia. We ended up moving to Detroit. Got kicked out of the community. So that's, again, a whole another story.
Right.
Because there's levels to that story too.
Yeah.
But then of course, when it came down to Georgia, we kind of moved away from the Islam, community, and we pretty much, gravitated back to our own history. And my mom was Caribbean, of course, Jamaican. So we pretty much, just went back to the roots, So I learned about my culture through my grandma coming and staying with her in Georgia. And, from there, like I said, life turned, even from there, because we ended up, my mom passed away from lupus on Mother's Day. And then my grandma sent me to foster care. So I grew up in foster care for 15 to about, 18, but technically I was still at Warder State. So I went to college, and then I didn't actually sign, my release papers until after college.
Yo.
So yeah. So that's what I mean by this story is all in between those stories. So, that was kind of like I said, my early beginning. And the main difference is in Philly, in the Islamic community, Muslim community, it was, again, predominantly black.
Yeah.
When I went to foster care, it was predominantly white. So it was literally like jumping from one side of the tracks to the whole another side of the tracks. My foster man, yeah, absolutely. Yeah. My foster parents were 60s, white, and from Louisiana. And I was their first black kid. I grew up with nine brothers, you know what I'm saying? So again, this is foster kids from all walks of life, you know what I mean? So I got to learn about a whole different world, and plus the foster home that I grew up in, Christian City, of course, is Christian based. So you talking about going from Muslim to Christianity, you know what I'm saying? So it's polar opposites, but at the same time, I learned about the similarities as well, you know what I'm saying? So I'm able to add that context in my art, and in my story as well. You know,
would you say the similarities between Christianity and in the Islamic community kind of kept you going? You know, because as you're growing up, you're seeing so many different aspects and perspectives of life. As a young one, I feel like that may be kind of tough. Talk to us about it.
Well, like I said, at first it was a culture shock because, again, you know, my name's Arshaad. You know, this is the first time, you know, the kids in my class, I mean, not even my class, the kids that I lived with even saw a black person. And they, you know, they trying to pronounce it, you know, Rashad, Rasheen. Like, nah, it's Arshaad. You know what I'm saying? Gosh. And that was even a challenge, too, from my house parents because, you know, they was like, well, can we call you something different? I'm like, whoa, hit the brakes. Because my mom named me Arshaad for a reason.
Right.
You know what I mean? Arshaad represents righteousness. You know, the meaning itself means upright. And then, of course, the root word of Arsh is throne, right? So all of that, you know, it's power in words. It's power in, you know what I'm saying, how you name your kids. So with my mom passing, I was like, you know, we could change my whole world, but I'm not changing the name. No. So, you know what I'm saying? So that's what it is. So I'm here. While I was there, I was a mentor with at-risk teens. Like I said, you know, in foster care, you're dealing with kids that, you know, been through all kind of stuff, you know, what led them to where they was at.
Yeah.
But because, again, I did know my history. I was 15, so I wasn't necessarily confused. You know what I'm saying? Like a lot of the kids that kind of grew up in foster care, you know, they didn't know nothing about nothing. You know, they like MLK, Black History Month, what is that?
Yeah.
We actually didn't even celebrate Black History Month while we were there because of that reason. But so like part of their, I guess, fundamental idea is that we're all the same color. We're all the same under Christ. So they didn't really celebrate individualism and they didn't celebrate Black culture when I was there. So one thing that I couldn't do, for example, was grow my hair out.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? So that was something that was hard for me because I was like, man, I can't grow my hair out. I'm like, I'm Jamaican. You know what I'm saying? And everybody grows their hair out at some point.
And hair is such a part of your identity, like your identity too.
Yeah, absolutely. Absolutely. So, of course, you know, you got to follow the rules and all of that, you know, type of stuff, just to appease whoever. But as soon as I got out of the foster care, I grew my hair out.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? So me growing my hair out was almost like a Colin Kaepernick story.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
For real. It was literally like real close. Yeah. You know what I'm saying? Because, yeah, it is a big part of our identity. You know what I'm saying? And again, growing the locks out is a whole nother step because I had a fro for a good minute. And then I braided it up. But then even in college, coming out of college, I was still kind of like still transitioning, trying to figure out who I was, what I want to represent, like as far as going into the real world. And initially, after college, you know, I got out my degrees, you know, started a fraternity, you know, won a lot of accolades, but then I couldn't get a job. So then, you know, my foster parents was like, hey, well, you know, you got to cut your hair, you know what I'm saying? You know, it might be hurting you.
Yeah.
So that was rough. So I cut my hair and I regretted it. You know what I'm saying? So then when I was I felt like I was doing it to appease people or just trying to blend in.
Yeah.
But it wasn't authentic to how I really felt. Yeah. You know what I'm saying? So eventually when I had my daughter, that's when I was like, you know what? If I'm going to be an artist and if I'm going to be telling this story, I wanted to tell the story from what it really is. You know what I mean? Going back to my roots.
Taking ownership.
Yeah, absolutely. So if I'm an artist, hey, this is what it is. You know, my hair is an extension of me. It represents my culture. It represents my whole story, literally. Yeah. Because I started growing my hair the same time that I found out I was having my first daughter.
Yeah.
And then that's actually when I started the Bob Marley piece as well with the black light. So
heck yeah.
The journey is it's all in there.
Heck yeah.
Bro, when you said you've been growing it for 10 years, I was like, ain't no way. Like, man, that's a lot of hair, man. That's a lot of hair, bro.
Absolutely.
All right, so you told us you start off in Philadelphia make your way to Detroit and eventually make your way down here. What was school like? At that point, I mean, I feel like, like you kind of get somewhere, might make a friend, all of a sudden you're just like, woof.
Oh, yeah. I was moving around a lot. You know what I mean? That's why I said I've been all around, you know, the 285 circle, you know. We just kept moving, you know, looking for better opportunities and all that, you know. But it was a little strange because I was always an outcast. Like I said, you know, I had the kufi, you know, I had, you know, the handmade clothes, you know, like I said, the community, the whole idea was, you know, being able to, you know, create a community and produce everything on our own.
Yeah.
So they made their own clothes, they made their own food, all of that. So, you know, of course, you know, when you come into elementary school and people rocking J's and everything else, and you come in with the full garment, you know, the hijab and all that, you know, it kind of draws attention. So, you know, so that was, again, challenging. I kind of stayed to myself, really. I was kind of quiet, especially as a kid, because of the cultural difference. And because, you know, like, you know, the average kid don't really know, you know, anything about Muslim kids or anything like that. So what I did do was, you know, of course, I was an artist. So a lot of time I just let my art kind of introduce me.
Yeah,
and that's why I call myself the Brother Behind the Bristles, because I was silent. But again, you know, how I ended up communicating or making friends was creating art.
Yeah,
you know what I mean? When I do an art piece, you know, it would usually be like, you know, a cutie. Yeah. You know what I'm saying? Oh my gosh, can you draw me? And I'm like, yeah. What's your name? And then, you know, so even from elementary school, I always was, I guess, friends with the ladies because, you know, the ladies like art.
Yeah.
And then from there, you know, other guys be like, okay, well, you know, this quiet kid, you know, be having mad girls around him all the time. So, you know, so it kind of gravitated to them. So I was like quiet, but then I was also social at the same time because of, again, because of the art.
Yeah.
So that's how it works.
Okay. Yeah. Yo, okay. So you were like GQ smooth.
Oh, yeah.
So when did you start? When did you, can you remember your first painting? First drawing, what age was it?
First drawing, I don't know, man. You know what? Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles. That was the one I remembered the most. That's the proudest of.
Okay.
Because I started actually because my mom was an artist.
Okay.
So she used to do like fine art, you know, drawing like illustrations for greeting cards. Mm-hmm. She was doing paintings. She was actually learning and watching Bob Ross.
Yeah.
Doing the oil paintings. So when she was doing the oil paintings, I would be with my sketchbook drawing and coloring at the same time.
That's
so cool. I would kind of learn some techniques, you know, doing like that.
Yeah.
But then, of course, me, as a boy watching cartoons and all that, I was like, man, okay, painting fruits and all that is cool.
Yeah.
But what about these Ninja Turtles?
Yeah.
So, you know, when I was watching Ninja Turtles and then I found out that the turtles were named after artists, I was like, say less. Yeah. I'm the ninja. What you mean? Michelangelo. For sure. Because I was like, yeah, I know Michelangelo. I know Raphael. So I learned about the masters. And I was like, you know what? I was like, I'm going to be a master artist from day one. So that's always been the dream. Like, there was no other dream, you know, growing up. Mm-hmm. And then that's been a challenge, too, because, you know, people see art and being an artist as like hope dreams. You know, they like, oh, that sounds good. Yeah, you're really talented. Yeah, keep doing it. But it's like nobody really guided, like, okay, what do you do with the skills?
Right.
Like, once you develop it, how do you make money?
I feel like that is one of those that when you hear people like, oh, I'm an artist. Like, no, what's your other job?
Yeah,
mm-hmm. Exactly. Yeah. And I'm like, nah, that's what I do. Like, hey. I'm trying to learn because that's what my goal was from the beginning as a kid. Like, hey, I want to learn everything possible that I could learn to be able to master it.
Right.
You know what I'm saying? So I was, hey, if we go to the library, let me get the drawing books. Yeah. You know what I'm saying? So where other kids might have been looking at Dr. Seuss.
Yep.
I'm like, nah. Let me get the 3D forms with the Leonardo, you know, Da Vinci drawings, all of that. So that's how I started getting the anatomy drawings, doing muscles, and doing superheroes. Just like that.
Oh, so you already knew.
I had it figured out. I'll tell you right now, at that age, I was like trying to figure out like what Power Ranger I wanted to be.
Mm-hmm. No, at that age, I was trying to make sure the heart on the Mother's Day card, the Valentine's Day card to my mama was like
matched. One side wasn't bigger than the other.
Right.
But yeah, but folks love superheroes. That's what I'm saying. So like whenever I started doing the Ninja Turtles, then of course, you know, you had shows like Mortal Kombat, Game, Street Fighter.
Yep.
And then eventually, by the time I got to middle school, you know, my main man, who was kind of popular, he was like, yo, man, I buy these from you. I was like, because you know me, we grew up in poverty.
Yeah.
So, you know, I was the candy man at the same time, you know?
Heck yeah.
Selling art, hey, Jolly Ranchers, you know, Skittles. Like, I was doing all that, trying to help out, trying to make a little extra money for myself. So he was like, you know what? I pay you $5 for every drawing you do. So I started doing, like, you know, Sub-Zero, you know, all of that type of stuff, Blanca, you know, all the Street Fighter characters, and $5 a piece here, you know? And then eventually he was like, you know, kind of shopping it around, like, hey, man, oh, my man, he could hook you up, $5.
Yo.
So, yeah. So I've been, like, you know, I say 20 years creating art, but really I've been doing it since middle school.
Cool. I talked to some kids that are really good artists here in the school, and a lot of times, you know, I'm trying to get some art, and they're like, I don't really want to sell it because I don't, like, if I sell it, then it ain't fun. What's your message to the people that are artistic and have talents but are afraid to be commissioned for it because the love may dwindle?
The love may dwindle. That's a tough one. That's a tough one for me because I do know a lot of artists that that don't do commissions at all. Mm. They just create art, you know, for themselves or, you know, maybe for special occasions. But they don't want to get into, okay, here, I'm forced to have to create art for money. But what it, for me, it's like, hey, you know, this challenges you to constantly develop your skill, and it keeps you sharp, you know. So, yeah, you might not necessarily want to always draw portraits, you know. Sometimes you do need to take a break because, honestly, I'm taking a break right now. You know, I've been drawing portraits since college. And I'm like, man, you know what? Portraits is cool, but like you said, the context, the meaning, the connection is important.
Yeah.
So you never don't, you never really want to lose that. So always learning. You know, and then also when you're creating art for other people, stay within the community. You know, sometimes having a community of other artists around you will empower you. So that way it's like, you know what, if you do get tired, at least you'll see maybe another artist or maybe another artist in a different type of field or different content. So maybe you might see a photographer and be like, okay, the photographer is now inspiring me to develop my art skill. Or the graphic designer is getting me to, okay, you know what? Now that I know about graphic design, how can I add text to my design?
Yeah.
So, like, just kind of staying within that art community, even though if you are doing commissions, kind of helps you and kind of empowers you to keep developing your skill, keep developing, stay passionate at it.
Yeah.
Gotcha.
That's it.
The iron sharpens iron.
Yeah, man.
Absolutely.
For sure.
Heck yeah.
Absolutely.
All right, so you said you've been doing art since middle school. I like music. I think everyone likes music. What kind of music were you listening to in middle school?
Middle school, whew, let me go back. Man, you talk, oh, middle school, yeah. You talk about 90s.
Where were you in middle school? Like, were you in Georgia?
Yeah, I was in Georgia. Yeah, I came to Georgia when I was 9.
Okay.
So, yeah. But middle school, yeah, you talking about 90s. So, I was definitely on, you know, Tupac, Biggie, Bone Thugs, right? All of those 90s folks. And, of course, later on, got into, you know, DMX, you know, because, you know, again, you know, a lot of the music that I connect to is about struggle. It is about, you know, trying to fight adversity or overcome. You know what I mean? Because that's been a part of my life. So, of course, artists that's similar, like DMX, who also grew up in foster care, you know what I mean? I connected with those type of stories. You know, Eminem, of course, was popular as well.
Yeah.
So I had a couple Eminem albums. But when I went to foster care, they took all my stuff. They took all my music.
No.
Yeah, man. So all of those, I had, you know, I had the CDs with the case. Nah. They was like, nah, this ain't going to work. You know, it's cussing, secular music. So then, so once I dumped all of that, then, because I went to foster care in 99.
Okay.
So then once I dumped all of that, we was on, I actually got introduced to rock music. Like I said, my foster brothers, you know, like I said, they was into rock music, Metallica, you know what I'm saying? You already know. That kind of helped me. Yeah, that helped me diversify, you know, my repertoire. And I connected with a lot of the outcasts of, you know, the punk rock era, you know, similar type of struggle, but just a different sound, you know what I mean?
Right.
So, you know. I call myself a rock star.
Oh, man. All right, so you get out of middle school, you get into high school, I feel like arts are already kind of like your go to. Mm-hmm. So let's push to like by the time you get ready to leave high school, graduate. Do you have a plan? Are you just freelancing? Figure freelance kind of funny word to use with arts, but like. Or like, is it just kind of whatever happens? Like, what's the move?
You said coming out of high school?
Yeah, coming out of high school. What's your plan? Yeah.
Let's see. Coming out of high school, I got a lot of guidance from my art teacher, really, because I was in foster home, and you know, it was a scary moment. Mm-hmm. It's like, hey, you know, the biggest fear of somebody in foster care is being homeless. Mm. You know, because when you get out, it's like, what do you do? you can't necessarily, but mentally, you're disconnected from your family. You know what I'm saying? So because everybody disconnected from you during that time, it's like after high school, it's like you can't really go back to the cousins that stopped talking to you for 2 years while you was in foster care. So it's just like you're on your own.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? So when I got out, my idea was, and that's why I say when I got out, because that's a whole nother thing. Because my senior art show was named Doing My Time, because literally while I was there, my freedom is being taken away from me. Because before, you know, I used to be outside. You know what I mean? When you're growing up in the hood, in the community, like everybody know each other. So we outside, you know, you congregating. As soon as the school bus drop off, you walking around, etc. But when I went to foster care, it was rules. Hey, man. There ain't no going outside without permission. Well, there ain't no going outside without some type of surveillance or some type of people watching you. You know, those, you know, real strict rules. Certain sports you couldn't play, and then you know, there was no prime. There was no calling folks, you know, at home. No. There was barely any visitation from family, so there was no visitation from friends. So literally, I felt like. You know, like you know what I'm saying, institutionalized. You know what I'm saying? Like doing my time. So, yeah. So my whole senior art show was all about doing my time. So I was like, you know what, working towards, you know, what would I do when I'm free?
Where is,
you know what I'm saying?
Can we see that somewhere online?
Oh, yeah. I just posted it recently, actually, because long story short, well, actually full circle, last year, the foster home that I grew up in actually contacted me and was like, hey, we want you to do a mural outside of this new building that we just created. Dang. And, you know, we love your story. And we feel like the kids growing up, you know, could connect to it. So, yeah, so they commissioned me to come up with a design, and I was on the news and all that, you know. So
that's amazing, man.
So where can the people find you on social?
Instagram, Art by Arshaad, ArtByArshaad. ArshaaD. Okay. One and only.
Okay. Gotcha.
One on one.
Heck yeah.
That's what's up, man.
But yeah. That's what I mean by this story is behind every piece that I do. You know what I mean? And the connecting theme is unity and liberation. Yeah. Always. Because of my story. I've always been, again, fighting for family unity.
Right.
Fighting for freedom. You know what I'm saying? Because, again, you know, you don't realize how much freedom you have until those things taken away from you. Right. You know what I'm saying? So coming out of high school, it was like, dang, okay. I'm fighting for freedom, fighting for my own identity, right? As far as my hair or what I want to do in life. So my goal was, of course, college, because that was like the only idea.
Yeah.
Art was the only choice. But I was trying to even think about animation, graphic design. So I shopped around a couple of different schools, got a scholarship to Savannah College of Art and Design.
Okay.
But at the time, they didn't have housing, and I didn't have a car, right? Because, again, you know, where I was at. So so I didn't end up going there. And so my art teacher actually told me about Lagrange College, you know, drove me to the tours. And, yeah, that's how it all happened.
So you step foot on campus at Lagrange College.
Mm-hmm.
What's your major?
Art and design.
Okay, art and design.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, heck yeah.
Absolutely. Concentration, drawing and painting. And then a minor in graphic design. Because, you know, there's like, hey, well, you know, learn a little bit of graphic design. Because that's a whole another, again, topic.
That's where we at right now.
That's a whole another topic because, and not even just where we at in the world, it's because, again, I went to a school that specialized in fine art, right? And this is a predominantly affluent school, predominantly white school, mm-hmm. Lagrange College.
Right.
Yep.
But the problem with that, I guess, direction from my art teacher, her perspective was like, okay, hey, I know you want to be an artist, and but I don't necessarily want you to limit yourself by just going to an HBCU, because I was thinking about Morehouse and, you know, stuff like that.
Yeah.
And she was like, well, you know, you got skills that can go beyond just the HBCU, realm. Yeah. You know what I mean? What your skill or your talent can gravitate to people from all different, you know, ethnicities, all different backgrounds. So she was like, don't limit yourself. So that was her idea of going to Lagrange College. But I'm like, if you go to a PWI, that sounds good, but the reality is, I'm still black.
Yeah.
I'm still black. So I won all the awards, you know what I'm saying, at the college, you know, one of the top performers, top artists there. But when I graduated from there, it was hard finding work. I was like, dang, you know what? I done been through all of this, you know, overcoming, et cetera, just to get out of college, you know what I'm saying, 3.5 GPA, no job. You know what I'm saying? Nothing. So that was disheartening. That was rough. You know, so I ended up becoming a school counselor. I'm sorry, not a school counselor, a camp counselor.
Okay.
Working with at-risk teens, you know what I'm saying, that been through adoption and all kind of stuff. Yo. So that's what got me into almost education.
Okay.
By doing the camps. So, you know, because it was a challenge getting into the art world, I was like, okay, well, I started working as a graphic designer, as a graphic artist, and then when I lost that job during the Great Recession, that's what transitioned me into teaching. So I started teaching at alternative school, you know what I'm saying? Because I felt like I was pretty good at working with, you know, at-risk teens during the camp. I was like, hey, you know what, I could do this alternative school thing.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? And then, so when I did that, that's when I went back to school, got my master's,
okay,
and started working at Jonesboro High School.
Now, where'd you go to school for your master's?
I actually did it online.
Okay.
I did it online while I was working security for about a year and a half. So it was University of Phoenix. Okay. Got my master's in secondary education.
Heck yeah.
So, yeah, man.
Yo. You know, in your story, I just keep hearing grit, man. Grit and grind, bro.
Oh, yeah, like, yeah, yeah. Just, absolutely. Ain't none of this easy.
I can't wait till our kids hear this, man.
Nothing came easy.
A lot of times we see success as like something we can just, we have an idea, and then tomorrow we'll be successful. Like, nah, that ain't really how it goes.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Like, it's going to take some time and some grind.
Yeah, yeah. And I'll be trying to tell the students, like, hey, it's more than just creating art and then just posting it online and hoping somebody see it.
Mm-hmm.
Like, nah, you got to do exactly what I'm doing right now. I'm literally showing you, hey, I'm teaching, I'm working, and I'm still taking off, and I'm still working.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
Like, work don't stop. Right. You know, I'm 40 years old. Like, if you're going to choose art, it's a lifetime.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
You know, yes, you know, I could say, hey, you know what? Yeah, I won this award. But at the end of the day, hey, man, that award was 3 years ago.
Yeah.
This award was 5 years ago. This award was 6 years ago. What you doing now?
Yeah.
Yeah.
You always got to have the grind. You always got to be hungry.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? So if you're going to choose it, I understand that, you know, hey, it takes grit. You know, it takes patience. It takes passion. You know? For real.
Thank you. Yeah, you know, one thing that I really noticed, and I think it's just because I'm a history guy, is during the program today, you kept alluding to, like, you're doing your research and you were looking at the history part of things.
Yeah,
And from a history guy, I'm sitting here, I'm like, yes, yes. Yeah, so I, as a history teacher, thank you for just pouring everything into it. And
that's it,
man. Y'all just look him up on Instagram and take a look at some of his stuff. 'Cause I did it before the show and, yeah, you owe it to yourself. Just do it. So you get into the education world.
Mm-hmm.
What does education look like for you coming into it kind of later?
Well, let's see. How old was I? Well, that was 14 years ago. So that was like, what, mid-20s? At first, you know, it sounded awesome. I ain't going to lie. It was like, hey, we need guys like you, big, strong, black men. You know what I'm saying?
Where have I heard that?
Fathers. I'm like, man, okay, all right, yeah, I do it. Yeah, why not? I'm good with kids, you know what I mean? Like I said, I can deal with, you know, whoever. It don't matter to me. So at first, I did feel like, okay, I was giving back to the community. I felt like, okay, you know what? They appreciate me, especially at Jonesboro High School. They was real excited. The whole community was excited because when I came in, the art teacher that was there, you know, she was drained. I mean, you know, she was like, I'm talking like, man, head down, folks throwing airplanes, you know, it was looking like Dangerous Minds up in that classroom. I was like, hey, for real? Because then, yes, the alternative school was right next to the Jonesboro High School.
Okay, okay. Gotcha.
So I was at the alternative school, but I used to come and, you know, check out, see what's going on in the art room, you know what I mean? But then she was like, I'm done. You know what I mean? So, and she was like, you got it if you want it. I was like, what? okay. Well, let's revamp this. Let's throw some light in here, you know? So we ended up remodeling the art class first year. The art club, you know, went from like two kids that, you know, barely do anything, just do anime, to like 50 kids, you know? So like the next year.
Yeah.
And so they was loving it. The folks in the community gravitated behind me. They was like, man, you know, the art program been kind of slow. And, you know, you re-energize and, you know, it's like you don't know how much, you know, just your presence, you know, reinvigorates the program.
Yeah.
Right.
So yeah, that was dope. You know, teachers, parents, folks from the community was coming out to the first art show I did out there. So, yeah, it was dope. But then, of course, just like everything else, the Great Recession happened. The housing market crashed.
Yeah.
When the housing market crashed, funding for the schools ended up slowing down. So the CTAE and the fine art programs were the first ones to go. They was like, hey, you know what? Hey, we love what you're doing. And I did a whole mural on the outside of the school, you know, had the chief of, you know, human resources and everybody from the county come over. Same day, they gave me the letter and said, your contract been discontinued.
Whoa.
Yo. I was like, man. Yeah, and it's like at the end of the year, you know, where everybody's celebrating. I did the whole unveiling ceremony, and then the AP, the assistant principal, he was like crying. He was just like, I ain't even want to do it, but here, man, we got to cut you because of the program. So that sucked, you know what I'm saying? But that was my initiation into teaching. You know what I'm saying? So I felt valued and devalued at the same damn time. Just like that. You know what I'm saying? So then when I got let go, in the summer I was depressed, and then I ended up getting a job. They was like, hey, why don't you go down to Riverdale? And so, I don't know if you know about Riverdale.
Not much.
Man, Riverdale was literally like being sold down the river.
Wow.
You know what I'm saying? I'm telling you, the junk was rough. I thought Dangerous Minds was that one classroom. Nah, that was nothing compared to Riverdale. I'm talking about folks. It was dangerous in that classroom.
Gotcha.
You know what I'm saying? Folks was jumping each other like every day. It was wild. It was just like straight chaos. But then the principal that was there, she was like, yo, I heard good things about you. Can we do something about the walls? Because the walls had like graffiti and all that on it. So we written up painting it. And then I ended up adding two quotes in there. It was a Nelson Mandela quote and a Gandhi quote. Education is the most powerful weapon you can use to change the world. Mm. You know what I'm saying? I put that on the wall, right? And so that was on one side of the building. And the other side of the building was live life as if you were to die tomorrow. Learn as if you were to live forever. Mm. So that was the two quotes that I wanted to, you know what I'm saying, share with the students. Because I was like, a lot of people was looking hopeless. You know what I mean? Like the graduation rate was real low. And the reason why it was chaotic is because, like you said, when you're community folks that don't really value education,
yeah,
it's just like, what's the point of this? You know what I'm saying? So they bring the street mentality to the school. So all that to say, when we did the mural, kids helped with the mural. And I do that on purpose. Like, hey, you know what? It's not about just me creating art. If I can get another student to also create this art, it's that much more empowering.
Yeah.
So from then on, I always had students incorporated into the murals in the school. From there, we ended up doing an art show, a step show. I collaborated with the step team. We did like a whole Egyptian Sphinx, you know, backdrop.
Yeah.
And I mean, hey, the community loved it. You know what I'm saying? So they was like, oh man, you know, like to transform a school of hopelessness to a school of empowerment, it's like, come on, man, they're gonna remember that forever. And people literally to this day hit me, hey man, I remember what I remember in Riverdale, I remember in Jonesboro. And that feels great, you know what I mean? Because now my kids, or the kids that are basically raised, they grew up, you know what I'm saying? Got their own kids. So it's just like full circle, you know what I mean? So it really, it teaches you, like, hey, you know what? When a kid sees me at a Black History Month program and I'm doing this painting, sometimes it can seem like, oh, well, that's just a nice art piece. But I'm like, in my mind, I'm like, no, I know what I'm doing. I know when a kid sees Bob Marley with them locks, I know that makes them feel good.
Right.
You see what I'm saying?
Yeah.
So just knowing how it impacts the kids, that's what tweaked my art purpose.
Yeah.
You know, because now it's not just, okay, hey, I'm creating art to just get these accolades. It's I'm creating art for a reason to inspire and to educate, you know, students about themselves. So that's what it is.
Yeah, I got glory bumps. I'm just like, dude, that's
yeah, man.
I have no words.
But no,
that's the sigma on his finger.
Oh yeah. I was trying to tell my fraternity because the thing is, I had showcased this piece. I want to say 2016 at my fraternity's conclave, and that was different as well because, you know, of course I pledged Phi Beta Sigma fraternity. But this is the first time that my fraternity actually had an art show. Yo. You know what I'm saying? So I was like, oh, the fraternity got an art show? Oh, boom. Let me get out there. So then I was like, you know what? We got all of these honorary people, you know, like Emmett. You got, who else? Bill Clinton. You know, you got all these different honorary people that were, you know, got into the fraternity later on. But I was like, if we're going to have anybody in there, why not make Bob Marley as an honorary, you know what I'm saying? Hey, his message, is, you know, we stand for social action, brotherhood, you know what I'm saying? Education, all of that. Yeah. So I was like, hey, man, somebody need to go ahead and pitch this idea. So that's why I put the little taste of the fraternity symbol on the that's ring, cool. You know what I'm saying?
That's cool.
Absolutely. Somebody need to make it happen, for sure.
Someone will listen to this.
yeah.
You have one job.
Because, people give posthumous, you know what I'm saying, celebrations all the time.
All the time.
Yeah. Absolutely. So, man.
So it's like, at first when you're talking about going to Riverdale, in my head I'm thinking like, Lean on Me.
Oh, no, it was just like that. Yeah. I was going up in Free Mr. Clark. You know? All of that. Hey, man. I was breaking up pregnant girls from fighting in my classroom. I had a student that got shot in the eye first week of school.
What?
I was like, dang, dog. And then another kid shot in the leg. I was like, man, bro, what y'all doing?
Yeah.
What you trying to kill yourself? Hey, man, come on, man. Let's go outside. What you doing? Like, come on, man. But, yeah, they just didn't see it. But then when I was showing those same students art, it was like it gave them a whole nother energy. Yeah. You know what I mean? Because like a lot of the folks that was caught up and got shot, you know, it's because of the folks that they were around.
Yeah.
Oh, me and my clique, you know, me and my brothers, cousins, et cetera. I'm just like, yo, man, there is another way. I was the same way. You know what I mean? In middle school, high school, before I got to Christian City, I started hanging around, you know, folks that was in the gangs like that. Because, you know, like you said, when you're growing up listening to certain music, it's like that type of lifestyle is, for somebody that's hopeless, that is hope. That's you know, hope. Like, hey, you know what? Oh, I could be in a clique where my whole clique run the school? Oh, say less. Well, what I got to do?
Dude, you know? The universe works in full circle.
It does, man.
So, because I know the powers that be might listen to this episode, too. last week?
2 weeks.
2 weeks ago?
Yeah.
So we had Department of Juvenile Justice come to the county, and they had a little seminar and talking about gang violence and gang activity in the schools.
Mm-hmm.
And so it sounds like you've been in a situation where you've had to deal with that, and apparently it's on the rise. And so me and Coach Williams had actually talked about doing an episode and just kind of free vent on it. Based on what I'm hearing you say, if we get students involved and get them bought into the school itself, it's almost like they don't have time to get in trouble.
Oh, no, no. Yeah, right? Yeah, yeah. It opens up your mind.
It's crazy.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah.
So if the powers that be are listening, mm-hmm. Dalton Reed, I'll put my name on it, let's give the kids a reason to want to be here.
Jay Will, and Justin Williams seconds that.
That's exactly what you gave your kids a reason to want to do it. And you said you added your students into the art. So now they can walk by and they're like, hey, look, I did that. Ownership, man.
Absolutely. And the thing is, even though, of course, I taught art, and then my class was pretty much used as a dumping ground. You know, let's keep it real.
Yeah.
I was the one that, because I was a big dude, and because I've, been in street life and, as an educator and as a mentor, they was like, hey, oh, you can handle it.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? So I would have 30, 40 students easy in my class every day, five, six classes a day. Yeah. So, but the problem with that is I got all the ISS kids. I got all of the alternative school kids. I got all the kids that you know what, hey, he's already failing in all his classes. Here, just do something with him.
You ain't got AP.
Yeah. They wasn't giving me AP art students. Not at all. So every year was a challenge. No matter how good, and that's what I mean by context is important. Because it's you can see all these accolades, teacher of the year. But this teacher of the year without AP students.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? These ain't I grew up my whole life wanting to be an artist. This is kids that, hey, I don't know what I want to do.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. I just don't like going to other classes. Yeah. You know what I mean? So eventually I was like, you know what? At first I was mad. I was like, man, dang, they sold me to kids that don't even want to be here.
Yeah.
But I was like, let me flip this. Yeah. Because obviously I'm here for a reason.
Right.
Yep.
You know what I'm saying? And I do have a skill to connect with, the kids that are forgotten. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
So I was like, you know what? That's going to be my journey. That's my purpose. So that's what I'm going to stick with. So going forward, it was like when I'm creating murals around the school, I would get the kids that are skipping to help out more than even my own art kids.
Yeah.
It was the kids that's outside, that never go to class, that's smoking, that's in the bathroom. I'm like, hey, man, in the bathroom again? I need something to do, man. Come on. Come on, man. Hey, I got stuff that need cleaned up. And they was with it. It was like, hey, all right, I ain't got nothing else to do. I'll go clean up the paint. I'll go add on something.
Anything but sit and doggone calculus.
Yeah. That's what I'm saying. So I was like, word. And then that's what changed the culture of the school. That's what I'm trying to tell people. I'm giving you the blueprint.
Right.
Yeah. It's just a matter of putting the money and putting the time into the kids that you don't want to put in time to.
Yeah.
Because those kids inspired all the other kids.
Yep.
You know what I'm saying? Like when they have 5-10 kids that's in the bathroom jumping people, come in and working on an art piece, and I'm telling them, hey man, so and so just did these, that makes the kids in my class be like, oh dang, you know what? This is bigger than just an assignment. Mm-hmm. Yep. This is more than just, trying to do something pretty.
Yep.
So, yeah.
Yo.
We run with it. That's it.
You embrace those kids, too, man.
Yeah.
The kids skipping probably felt like nobody else cared about them.
But absolutely.
Come holler at me. I got something for you.
Absolutely. And that's what I mean by even going back. Before foster care, at 9 years old, I posted a story. I don't know if you've seen it. The Ali drawing. Check it out. Because that one's a tough one. It's called Teach Me How to Float.
We're gonna look right here on the spot.
Yeah. Check it out. Instagram, Teach Me How to Float. That was a pivotal piece for me. Because like I said, I was a quiet kid, elementary. Oh. But then that incident right there happened. When I was 9 years old, I got pushed into the deep end by my stepdad on purpose. So when I came out of that water, and I survived it. It made me an angry kid. You know what I'm saying? Oh. I was upset, and that's what kind of got me hanging around other kids that was angry and upset. You know, for real. So then that's when I got into a lot of school fights. So it was like, it was hard. And the reason why I was angry and getting into school fights is because I never told nobody what happened. Because of course, where you live in that, snitching is that's a no-no, and then snitching on your parents, that's definitely a no-no, because DFAT's going to come take you.
Yep.
And that was a threat. So, whenever I was going through that, it was, it bothered me. So I used to walk around with that chip on my shoulder, you know what I'm saying? So that's what made me gravitate to other kids that walked around with a chip on their shoulder, what I mean?
Okay.
Just that like that. Yeah. So that's how I'm able to connect with, ruffians because I was that ruffian for a minute, you know, until, of course, my mom passed. And then that's when I was like, you know what? They was like, yo, if you keep fighting and keep, you know, connected with the wrong kids, you're going to be dead. Like, you're going to, you know, like, you're not going to be able to fight everybody.
Just the reality.
Like, yeah, you're not going to be able to fight everybody.
Right.
And then ninth grade year, like I said, I had cousins that was in the Jamaican posses and all that. And my cousin got murdered. You know what I'm saying? Open the door, gang violence. You know, shot him right there at the front door. Yeah. You know what I'm saying? Execution style. So then when that happened, I said, you know what? I think I'm going to chill on, you know what I'm saying, trying to be a thug. You know what I'm saying? Let me refocus. And then that's what made me end up switching into, you know, focusing more on the art instead of just hanging out with other dudes that was upset and, you know, trying to make money.
Dude. So I'm getting you're a humble dude because you've talked about accolades, but you haven't really dove into them.
Nah.
So I'm going to ask you really quick to put humility to the side. Talk to us about the accolades.
I got accolades.
What was the very first one? What was your very first prize, award, recognition?
Or at least the one that made you go like.
Yeah.
Okay, so that was the triumph. That was the art show Champion Spirit with Arts Clayton. Okay. That was my first time winning an art competition. And it was winning the art competition based off of my own thought. Wow. So that's what made me feel like,
I could do this.
Because I knew that it was going to be a challenge, or I knew that it might be a little controversial, really, me having the Obamas deified. And because some people was like, oh man, so what you trying to say? This is, you trying to put them as like a god status. And I'm like, no, I'm putting it right back where they belong. Like, this is history. Like, if you go back to the original image, the image looked just like Barack and Michelle, except now it's, you know, thousands of years later. Yeah. So it's like, hey, just being able, for people to be able to see the original sculpture and see the Barack Obama one, is like, oh, he didn't just depict him as a god. He basically put him back right on the throne. Yeah. You know what I'm saying? Right where it was supposed to be.
Yeah.
So, you know, here it is, you know, manifestation right back. Right. So when I did that, that also, because like just to, like I said, it's context to everything. The Muslim community that I grew up in was heavy into Kemetic culture and heavy into the study of Egypt.
Yeah.
So the Muslim community, Ansar Allah, actually transitions it to Nawabian community. So like I said, y'all can do y'all history on that. But just to give you a little story. So there's a place called Eatonton, right? That's in Georgia.
Mm-hmm.
This was a farmland, right, in which there was an Egyptian-style commune there. So the triumph piece is actually me telling people about my story without them even knowing the story of again, the Nawabians in Eatonton, Georgia. What? So, like I said, that's a whole another story for a whole another topic. But that made me feel empowered to say, you know what, I could tell my real story.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? I can actually teach people about not only their history, about my history, and how I became who I am. So that was real, like, it was a gamble to do that, especially for an art show where, like, majority of the Obama pieces was like, oh my bad, majority of the Obama pieces was like, you know, the portrait, him with the suit on.
Yeah.
And I was like, nah. I'm like, anybody could do that.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? Kehinde, everybody else did that.
Yeah.
I was like, I'm gonna do something that's radical. I'm gonna do something that hits to the core of every person.
You're gonna push the envelope.
We're gonna push the envelope. Heck, absolutely. You know what I'm saying? Then him stepping forward through the hope symbol was again the Stargate. You know what I'm saying? Like, hey, you know, this is timeless. We're going from back to the present to the future. And that's actually that same piece is in the show called The Next 100 Years. So I just did that last year. And that was another accolade because that was the first time I did an art show outside of Georgia in North Carolina. To celebrate again, you know, 100 years going forward. So hear me.
You know, I remember being in a, I want to say I was like in freshman year of high school, mm-hmm. when President Obama was elected, mm-hmm. and as a biracial male,
yeah,
it was one of those where I was just like,
yeah.
It's like one of the first times that in, well, it was the first time in history that I could look at a president and go, hey, that guy looks like me,
yeah.
like, and I look like him,
yeah.
and I'm like, yes, like, and like even still today, like, so at the program. The gentleman, and I forgot his name.
Doc Fuller.
Yeah, Doc Fuller, when he, like, his Obama painting, like, I told him, I was like, dude, like, I don't know if you were, like, I said, you know, you might not have felt like you were talking to anybody, but I promise you, you were talking to me, bro.
Yeah.
Like, and so, like, and then when I saw your piece, I was just like, it was like validation.
Mm-hmm.
And it was just like, all right, cool. Like, it's you know, history is watching, and it's like it's constantly watching how we do and what we do, and are we bringing that honor to you know, everything that came before us and even after us.
Like I said, the inauguration was that moment. Yeah. You know, the inauguration made everybody feel like, yeah, that's right, we did that, you know what I'm saying? That's right, you know what I'm saying?
We made it,
yeah. You know? So it's
yes,
like,
we can.
Yes, we can. So that's it. So yeah. So I knew that people seeing it in that light and that color scheme with the hieroglyphs,
yes,
with the scarab, you know what I'm saying, the symbolism of resurrection coming out of it,
yes.
re-life, you know?
Yes.
I knew that even from a visceral standpoint, like without even really being able to read and dissect like what everything means, people know from to the core what that feels like and what that means, you know? So that's what it was about, the triumph.
Yeah.
You know?
So personal question. As an artist, you have so much time and effort and thought into your pieces. When I go to a museum, sometimes I see art totally different than what the artist probably mm-hmm. was trying to portray. Does that bother you?
No, it don't. Because a lot of times I do pieces for that reason. And because I know, as a teacher,
mm-hmm.
right, I study art. And then I also study how people receive art.
Okay.
And then as a graphic designer, that's what I teach my students. Like, hey, when you do a design, you need to learn your audience.
Yeah.
Like, don't just create art. Like, learn your audience so that way you know how they're going to receive it. And you know how they could receive it.
Yeah.
And then from there, now you literally can divert people however you want to.
Yeah.
Because that's when you're a master at it. Where you can say, hey, you know what? I want this Asian lady to receive it this way. I want this little baby to receive it this way. Yeah. And I want grandma to receive it this way.
The psychology of it, man.
The psychology. Yeah. The psychology of colors, the psychology of symbols, all of that. You learn it. And then when you apply it, master it, then you can send all kind of messages, which can be, again, liberate, but it can be dangerous as well.
Very true.
So that's what I learned as well. Going into art and creating art that is emotional or art that's connected to struggle. As an artist, you are responsible for how people receive your art. So that's whether it's music, you know, rap music, right, talking about gang violence, and it goes with art talking about, or showing black pain.
Yeah,
some of that stuff's traumatic.
Yeah,
so I actually made it to where I purposely didn't create black art as far as a pain standpoint.
Okay.
So none of my art is showing black death, you know, black violence.
Yeah.
Even though that's been a part of my life, it's like, you know what? If I have the ability to teach people something, teach people how to overcome that, not teach them how to dwell in the pain.
Yeah. Ooh.
See what I'm saying? So like this American Dream piece, it's a psychological piece.
Yo.
I'm pointing at it like it's right there. I'm pointing at it like it's right there. No, it's in the car. But it felt like it was right there for some reason. I don't even know why. But no, the American Dream piece, I know that, like, you know, you had different music that was going out around the time, 2018. You had, you know, kids in asylums. You had parents, you know, separation going on at the border. So it was a lot of political stuff going on during that time period.
Yeah.
And of course, Black Lives Matter movement was also going on during that time period.
Yes.
A lot of the art that was going out was like really traumatic for a lot of folks. Like a lot of people was like, yo, we don't really want to see this.
Yeah.
You know, like we see this on the news every day. Like we don't want to like have art that's going to stay in the house that reminds us of oppression.
Yeah.
So that's why I was like, you know what? You're right. Because if I saw pain and despair every day, just like on the news,
yes,
I'd be depressed too. Yeah. You know
well,
what I'm saying?
Well, what you consume is what you become.
Right? Yeah.
And people forget that.
Yeah, yeah. So now, like I said, as an educator, it's like, artists, you have the capability to inspire people through this. So instead of just showing, okay, here, you know, Amaya Stewart and Trayvon and everybody getting murdered and killed.
Yeah.
You know, because that's what sells during that time period.
Yeah.
They call that trauma porn. You know what I'm saying? Because people, you know, yeah, like there's actually a genre just like horror movies. Yeah. And people that they just like to see gore, pain, yeah, you know.
Well, fear,
that's a human experience.
Fear sells. It does. It gets clicks. It gets likes. It gets the ratings. And mm-hmm.
So yeah. So now as an art educator, I'm like, you know what? I'm in a space where I can incorporate my whole like life experience into my art to educate kids now. So I'm like, that's you know cool. what? Let me create art that has a little bit of symbolism that's gonna make them think,
yeah,
use their brain. You know. So that's just Yo. Like I said. That's how I tweak it. Make it happen.
I can't even see Bob Marley, but the color schemes and just, I don't even know what else to call it other than color schemes. It's just beautiful, man. It's yeah. a beautiful work of art.
Mm-hmm. It is. Mm-hmm.
So I don't know if you've seen the original poster, or that I kind of got the shape, the design from, but the original poster is like just all black background with like a white spotlight. So that right where that circle is uh-huh. like a white spotlight, and he's like on stage. And again, it's all black background. But I changed it because, again, of the context of his music and how, you know, it's almost like wailing, you know. So yes. he's singing, but it's almost kind of a plea at the same time.
Yes. It's like a cry for help.
A cry for help. Yeah, 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 yeah. So that cry for help for world peace, that's why I changed that globe shape or that light into the world. You know, so to have a third perspective outside of the world about the world.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? And then, of course, the flames, but also the sparkles as well. Because, like I said, you know, red means a certain thing, yep. right?
Yep.
Fire means destruction. But then, of course, green is the opposite of that, yep. right? Green is health. Green is prosperity. So when he's singing, you know, and, of course, the green coming from the locks, that's a whole other thing. Yeah. So that's yeah. what I'm saying. Like, yeah. I'm trying to give people the gems because it's magic in your hair. That's what I'm like, hey,
yeah.
believe it or not, if you do your history, again, you talk about nine ether hair and how it connects, and then there's a psychological effect to it when people see that. And when people see my hair for 10 years, it's like, it's intimidating, but it's empowering at the same time. Because it's like,
yeah.
I know what you had to do to be able to rock that hair and to yeah. grow it from where you grew it from.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? So, yeah, all of that. And then, of course, the hair is connected to celestial beings, to the universe, all of that. You know what I mean? There's magic in this.
Can I take your class?
Yeah, yeah. Yeah, yeah, yeah. I'm teaching daily.
Yo.
Yeah. What
you mean?
Yo. So, how long did that take?
It was broken up into different sessions. So, because I started on this, actually, it was a live painting. So I was painting live, you know, during like a, I think it was like a 420 event. Yeah. But, you know, I was painting live. I did that. And then I ended up finishing it later on afterwards. So the live painting itself, I think the event was like 4 hours. And then I took it home and worked on it for, I would say, probably another 4 hours. So 8 hours total.
Yo.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, man.
I just catch myself just like just
yeah, I'm
staring at it. It just grabs you.
Oh, yeah, 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 absolutely. And then, like you said, with the black light on it, it just gives it a whole extra oomph. You know yeah. what I mean? And
it brings it to life.
Yeah, oh, absolutely, exactly. Absolutely. Because think about it. And when I start thinking about art, I think about the audience. I also think about the placement.
Yeah.
Where would you put this piece? Like, where would y'all put this piece?
You talking about like
yeah, place,
anywhere?
Yeah, where would you place it at? In your house? Where, what room? Kitchen?
I'm putting that in my living room.
Living room? Okay.
I'm probably going to put that above my bed.
Okay, above the bed? Okay. So that's what I'm saying. So, like, whenever I was creating this piece, I was trying to think of, okay, the dimensions, how it could illuminate the space and yeah. what it would yeah. do to that space.
Yeah.
So, like, when you had this at a bar, it makes people think a little bit different than if it was in the house.
Yeah.
So at a bar, it's like, man, yo, that's a nice piece. But then when you add the illumination to it, it adds on, again, the purpose.
Yeah.
So the illumination is supposed to be not just an aesthetic, but it's also the idea of it's giving you knowledge. Green is the color of knowledge.
Yeah.
Knowledge in a dark space is literally our purpose. You know, we're supposed to enlighten students. We're supposed to, you know what I'm saying, guide them through darkness. You know what I mean?
Hey, this man did not take off of work today. He is still in the educating business. Yeah, yeah,
yeah. Certified audio gold.
God almighty. Dropping gems.
So it's important for who are you trying to reach? You know what I mean? Are you trying to reach, you know, just the average black art collector that's just trying to decorate their house? Or are you trying to reach people that's, you know, that's drinking their life away? You know what I'm saying? People that's smoking their life away. Yeah. Folks that, you know, that lost hope, that's just living day by day. Those are the people that I'm trying to sing this song to. You know what I mean? That's the purpose, you know? That's it.
You definitely got it. If no one else has told you, you hit the mark with this one.
Appreciate that. That's that one love. That's why I got the tat right here. Yeah. You know?
Yo.
Just like that.
Your students are blessed, and they don't even know it.
Man. No. And if they don't know it. They don't even know it.
And if they don't know it, y'all better listen, because y'all better know it. So talk to us about, like, the education side. So, like, what are you teaching now? Like, what's school look like for you?
So, yeah, I'm over at Westlake High School now.
Westlake, okay.
When I transitioned from Mays High School in 2020 during the pandemic, I ended up going to Westlake. Another art teacher that's there, you know, is active in the community. He does a lot of, you know, stuff for emerging artists and his students. So, of course, you know, I did an art show with him, Articulate ATL, Mr. Galbraith. And then that's how I was introduced to Westlake High School.
Okay.
So then I worked as the third art teacher there for about 3 years. But I felt like it wasn't growing. Because I transitioned there, they was already veterans, and I'm just like, I'm not trying to start over. Like, I'm too far in the game to be starting over. Yeah. Like, you know, I got a mission here. Like, I don't know if you know, but I was placed here for a reason. Yep. You know what I mean? I'm not placed here just to be a third string.
Yep.
Like, at all. So, you know, with that being said, hey, I play the game, but my goal is to impact the whole school.
Yep.
Yeah.
So a lot of people don't think that way. Because of, you know, my background, I realized that. I was like, you know what? Some people, like you said, you know, they cater to the artists that are, you know, that show skill, that have discipline.
Yeah.
But I'm like, what about everybody else? What about the students that wanted to take art, that didn't get signed up for art? Mm-hmm. Or the students that, again, they got skill but don't see a future in? Right. Like, who's going to speak to them?
True that, bro.
You know what I mean? So that's where I was like, you know what? Hey, man, art ain't just for the folks that got skill or that got, you know, connections. Art is for everybody. Art is for the community. It's for the public. So from there, I was like, you know what? I could make a bigger impact in this school if I switched to strategic graphic design. That's it. Why? Because, you know, of course, just like everything else, the budget, just like we were talking about earlier, the budget is limited to fine arts.
Yep.
But CTAE budget is way bigger.
Yes,
so is. Now I'm like, okay, well, as a graphic designer, graphic design encompasses technology and art. So, like, I can make connections with the audiovisual person. I can make a connection with the podcast person.
Yep.
I can make a connection at another school with the businesses in the community.
Heck yeah.
So I was like, yo, we can multiply this tenfold.
Yes.
You know what I'm saying? If you give me the right tools. Yes. So that's why I was like, you know what? I'm switching to graphic design. And I'm still teaching art, of course, in the summers, you know, doing my own program. But, yeah. You know, it's time to elevate. That's next level.
Do you have any upcoming events where you'll be open to the public, doing some painting, maybe some content talk, something? Do you have anything coming up in the works?
I actually got something coming up tomorrow, actually. Tomorrow I linked up with a whole bunch of Jamaican artists from all around the world, and we're doing a live IG. Because the thing is, it's a Bob Marley art show.
Okay.
That's happening in Rochester, New York.
Okay.
And so this restaurant actually opened up their walls, you know, for artwork from different artists around the world.
Yo.
So people shipped it in, and some people just, you know, submitted it digital. But basically, we're going to be talking about the art pieces on the closing reception tomorrow at 2 p.m. Okay. Live on my IG. So check me out.
Cool. All right. So March 1st, live on IG.
Bob Marley, this one right here.
Get on it.
That's what's gonna be there. Yep.
Cool. Yo.
Yeah, man.
Man, I still just catch myself. like when you hear awkward silence, we're just admiring. I'm just being honest. Yeah. Like it's just, it's a. I'll tell you, it's a. I'm a firm believer that the universe places people in the right place at the right time. I'm super grateful. So, I told you at the beginning we got some heavy questions. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. So with it being the last day of Black History Month, and I got a weird take on, like, Black history is American history. It's every day.
Yeah.
But
yeah.
Shout out to Morgan Freeman for putting that guy on blast in an interview. Have y'all seen that?
Nah, but it's all facts.
Yeah, there's a video. Like, he, this guy asked him, he's like, he goes, what do you like Black History Month? And Morgan Freeman's like, he goes, no. And the guy looks at him, he's like, what do you mean? He's like, Black history is like American history. He's like, you're Jewish. Would you want a Jewish History Month? And the guy's like, no. And he was like, so why would you ask me if I want to? So, in the sense of what we're celebrating, what we're trying to bring awareness to and try to just portray it in the correct way, mm-hmm. As a Black educator, mm-hmm. what is being Black in education done to you?
Man, it tried me for my life.
I'm fighting for my life.
Hey, man. You said, what does it mean to me?
But, what is being Black in education, like when you look at it, like, what is it, like, what are you trying to do as a Black educator?
I got you. Well, number one, I'm trying to show people that, you know, success looks different, you know, for every Black person, number one, yep. right? Because, you know, it's easy to say, okay, well, this is what Black looks like, and this is what Black success looks like. But I'm like, nah, I I'm not coming in with bow ties like, you know, the average Black teacher that's trying to, you know, set a certain example. I'm showing people that, again, hey, you can be on the top of your game coming in with locks, full beard, you know what I'm saying, yeah. talking how you want to talk if you learn what you need to learn and you walk by that, you know what yeah. I'm saying? So that's it. So every day my goal is, again, excellence. You know, so no matter, hey, if I might show up about 5 minutes late, but guess what? These students, man, we don't stop. You know, it's rigorous. You know what I mean? We excel. I don't care if it says AP on it or not.
Yeah.
All of my students are AP.
Yeah.
And that's what the expectation is as a Black person. Like, hey, man, there ain't no half slipping.
Yep.
You know what I'm saying? So I feel like as an educator, I'm leading by example, number one.
Yeah.
And number two, I'm trying to get them a skill that they can survive and they can thrive off of. Yeah. A lot of students, just like I seen here with the fashion show
yeah.
and, you know, the dancing and, you know what I'm saying, all of that, it's like, just like you said, that is Black history. That is our American history. You know, the music that we listen to, everything from the food, the clothes, all of that. It's like, you should be proud of this and understand that what you're doing is value.
Yeah,
you know right. what I'm saying? That's yep. it. You know, beyond, you know, it's value, not just from an intrinsic, it makes people feel good. Like, nah, like this, what you just did could literally, you know what I'm saying, feed yep. all of your family for generations.
Yeah.
You know, so I've tried to get in the bigger picture, you know, as a teacher, because it's real easy to kind of see just a small portion of it. And then that's something I also tell my students. I'm like, hey, I'm you just 20 years later.
Yeah,
you know what I'm saying? Yeah. So if you think of the back for the future, like I am from the future. What you mean? Like I'm literally showing you the future.
I'm still in that one.
I had Marty fly in my head like, you guys don't know this yet, but you're gonna love it.
Yeah. Hey man, that's it. I be trying to tell them like, hey man, look, somebody had to show somebody the steps. And then the thing is, like me growing up, like a lot of the stuff is trial and error. And then I realized, yo, it's a lot of gatekeeping going on. Folks that's just like, they don't want to give the whole game to the students. They only give like a part of it. Even college was like that. I was yep. like, hey, they taught you how to draw and paint and then, you know, make some business cards. But what does that do?
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? It don't stop there. Yep. Like, you know, it continues. Like, yeah. there has to be a pipeline to success.
Yeah.
You know, so me, I feel like, hey, if there's anybody that's going to be the pipeline to success for, again, the students that I'm trying to cater to,
yeah,
it's got to be me. So,
heck yeah,
you know what I mean? That's it.
So, looking back in like your life and looking back at like school, is there like one teacher, maybe like a handful of teachers that you look back and you're like, if I never met them, I wouldn't be where I am today. or any like any person, like if I don't bump into them, I don't know if I'm who I am today. That's kind of a tough one. So sorry.
Yeah. I mean, the first person that of course comes to my mind is the art teacher, right? Because again, it was a pivotal time in my life. Foster care, again, feeling institutionalized. Her classroom gave me freedom, and it actually got me back into art. So I actually stopped drawing for about a year during the whole transition to foster care. Because it was just like I said, my mom was an artist. So it was like I created art when she created art. So if she's my number one influence and she's gone, it's like, what am I doing?
Yeah. Why do I do it at all?
What's the point of doing it? You know what I'm saying? So, but then she was like, nah, like, you know, your mom gave you a gift, you know what I'm saying? And she's teaching you how to use your gift, you know, through poverty, through drama, through, you know, family separation. You got to use that, you know? So she got me re-motivated to, my junior, senior year to actually push it, sign up for AP, get my portfolio right, go to college.
Heck yeah. Yeah. Go. All right, so little fun question for you. So I'm a nerd. So you get your little Doctor Who TARDIS. You can go back in time. And you can go back in time. You can talk to a young Arshaad or at a time you're most impressionable. And you get to meet him. Are you going to tell him who you are? So that's part one. Are you going to tell him, hey, I'm you? Or do you kind of just leave it hidden? And what knowledge bomb are you dropping on impressionable you?
Impressionable me. I would probably just encourage patience. I would encourage patience, and again, not necessarily being hungry for the outcome, but just, again, embracing the process and just living life. You know what I mean? Like I said, growing up, I always like, I want to be an artist. I want to be an artist. I want to be the best, the top. You know what I mean? The Kobe mentality. Yeah. You know, like literally just like that. But it was like that hunger can almost, I don't want to say haunt you, but it can kind of like.
Starts to consume you.
Absolutely. Yep. Absolutely. Consume you. You know what I'm saying? So I was so consumed in because of everything going on, I felt like it was my only way out. Like, this is my skill. This is my talent. This is my only way out of poverty. And then what I would teach myself is, no, I mean, this ain't your only way. Yeah. Like, you know what I'm saying? This ain't your only way. Yeah. Like, don't put that type of pressure on yourself. Yeah. You know what I mean? Like, you're always going to develop. Yes, you got a skill. There's other skills that you can have, and then you, hey, like, live life, like, appreciate life. Don't just be consumed in, like, life is getting money, you know, being successful and just grinding. You know what I'm saying? Because I missed out on a lot of that stuff, you know, as a little kid, because I was so consumed in wanting to make money, wanting to be successful, wanting to be great. You know what I mean? Gosh. You miss out on hanging out with the kids, you know, like the girls that I was, you know, that was watching me doing art. I mean, I could have been spitting game, but instead I was just doing the art the whole time. Yeah, you know what I'm saying? I could have been having fun with it, you know? So it's like, yo, have fun, live life, enjoy your youth. Yeah. You don't get that time back. You know what I mean?
Gotcha. Man. All right. So I got two more. So, talking to just students in general, and I could say like minority students, but I feel like every student needs to hear this. Why should the students at Callaway High School, Westlake, or just in general, why should they go into art? And then even on the backside of that, like, why should they even think about like educating people in different art forms? Like, if you had to promote to them, like, how would you sell it to them?
I got you. Why should they create art? Well, that's something I struggle even with my own students, because, like you said, you know, so much of the world is all about, you know, economics. It's like, how do you get people to appreciate the world beyond economics? Like, how do you, you know, appreciate life and what art brings to your life beyond just the monetary gain of it? You know what I'm saying? So it's like, I have to get what I do is I show them the future. Like, okay, I know plenty of folks that buy art, that do this, et cetera, but why do old people get art? Why do old people have art? What's the point? Why do they have pictures? So we kind of break it down just like on a, just a, what's the point of having a picture on the wall? You know, what does that do for a space? What does that do for your, for the average person? Why spend money on that? It's because, again, just the same way as having a color on the wall. Yeah. What does that color do for you? So, you know, so sometimes you got to break it down to what does color do in a classroom?
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? Like, you see all white walls, bricks. What does having these blue lights do to this space? You know what I'm saying? Yeah. What does it do?
Yeah.
So that's what art does. You know what I'm saying? It, you know, it illuminates it. It makes you, it literally triggers your brain to work more. You know what I'm saying? So it's like you get to appreciate life from a whole different perspective, and even more when, again, you incorporate color, texture, shapes, you know what I'm saying, symbols. Like, just those small elements can literally be healing, you know. And then so something like, even like for during the pandemic, hey man, that was something that the World Health Organization pretty much said across the globe, like, hey, it was the arts that kept everybody alive.
Yes.
Like, from a mental standpoint, it's like, yo, like, everybody, oh, man, art, I don't got no money for that. What's the point?
Yeah.
I mean, music, visual art.
TikTok.
Animation. TikTok. That's what kept kids going.
Yeah.
Like, that's literally what kept kids from dropping out of schools. Yeah. Like, you know what I'm saying? Having those programs where they could still be creative when the world is shut down. Hey, man, I could still appreciate green, right? Yeah. I can still appreciate blue skies.
Yep.
I can appreciate the animals, you know what I'm saying, that I'm seeing flying, like, you know, the birds.
Yeah.
Like, you just have a whole different appreciation to it. But what I'm telling them is like, yo, art and, you know, nature is synonymous. Like, it's all just a reflection of life. Mm-hmm. So when you sit back and you look at, you know, what is it that gains happiness, a lot of that is art related. So what you're doing is you can instill that into not only yourself, the people around you, your community, but you can give that to your kids, especially during times where you feel hopelessness, especially during times where, yo, ain't nothing else. You don't have nothing else. That's it.
Literally nothing else.
Dang. Man, there's just been so much audio gold. Just knowledge bomb after knowledge bomb.
Appreciate y'all. I'm just freestyling, you know what I'm saying?
Yo. So, last question for you.
Mm-hmm.
All right, so you finally reached, so we're going to fast forward, go to the future. You finally reached a point where you're like, look, I'm done teaching. I'm just going to hang it up, ride off in the sunset. What legacy do you want to leave? Like, when your name is brought up, how do you want to be remembered?
I mean, hey, you know, I feel like that's kind of like an existential type of question, right?
Yeah.
It's like, what's the overall like goal? What's the idea? What's your purpose in life?
It's like the write your eulogy question. I always hated that one, but you reach retirement, how do you want to be remembered?
Hey man, hey, I want to be the person that again, you know, somebody that said, hey, you know what? He got me to think. He got me to appreciate art. He got me to appreciate my own culture. You know what I'm saying? He felt empowered, you know, to who I am, you know, the hair, the colors, the even the busted shoes. It's like, yo, hey, man, I tell students, like I said, from all different points of life, like, yo, man, it's not about, you know, trying to get all the ladies and get all the bags.
Yeah.
Like,
yeah.
Sometimes it's like, hey, man, by the end of the day, I want to be able to show all my dirty shoes. When I'm old, like, hey, this shoe right here, it got paint on it from this particular event.
Yeah,
this junk right here is busted from walking 3 miles, you know, my car wasn't working.
Heck,
you know what I'm saying? Because, again, you know, people appreciate that. It's like, because I can tell people about accolades all day. But it's like, how can those accolades help the average person, the average father, the average, you know, I guess that kid, you know what I'm saying? That's who I'm trying to connect to, and that's the legacy I want to leave beyond just, okay, here, this is how you win awards.
Mm.
You know what I mean?
The man said he's just freestyling. I love to hear him when he thought it out.
Yeah. I'm gonna work on that. When I'm not working on everything else.
Dude, I can't say it enough. I'm... universe definitely put you in the right spot at the right time. And shout out to Dr. Walker for introducing.
Oh yeah, that's my dad.
For sure.
Man, Arshaad, it's been a pleasure, man. I'll tell you this, to leave me speechless.
Man.
It don't happen often. And when it does, it's profound. You've Dr. Walker told me you had a hell of a story. And
That's what I said. Go back and check out that Instagram story again. The Ali piece. There's some game-changing pieces, you know what I'm saying, that's in there. And some of them are just real small, you know, like the there's another one. It's called Heavy. You know, it's Mike Tyson one.
Through some of it.
We like punching the punching bag and the glasses breaking.
Yes.
Oh, man, that piece right there, again, it's inspired by pain because one of my favorite students actually died right before the pandemic. I guess it was COVID. I didn't even know it was COVID.
Yeah.
But, like, she was a top student, knocking out work. Next thing you know, she got sick Thanksgiving. Ooh. And didn't make it back from Thanksgiving.
Yo.
So when she passed, the whole classroom was heavy. The whole classroom was like, dang. She was literally just here right before Thanksgiving break. How she just get a cold and, you know, pneumonia and pass away like that?
Yeah.
Like, what happened? So that was a huge shock. And then from there, I was like, that took me back to, again, my mom's passing, the feeling of heaviness during that time. So I was just like, man, Mike Tyson, of course, was my hero at the time. You know what I'm saying?
Yep.
So I was like, you know what? I'm going to do a Tyson piece. Yeah. You know what I'm saying? Just to represent the heaviness of the classroom and everything going on. So yeah, that was an ink drawing right there. Yeah.
I'm just sitting here and I'm just like this. Y'all just got to check the man out on Instagram. I'm telling you.
Tell him where to find you again.
Yes.
Yeah. Instagram.com. Art by Arshaad. ArtByArshaad.
Yo, this Atlanta Forever piece.
Oh man, what? Yeah, I just did that one for a customer. Yeah. That's actually a mashup, Black Panther Thundercat mashup.
Yo,
you know what I'm saying? So I call that one the Black Panther multiverse.
Ah,
right.
Dude.
You know, a Spider-Man multiverse. Yeah, the different Spider-Mans mixed up, and technically they was like the Thundercats was a bite from Black History anyway, with the Sphinx character, you know, with the black symbolism, and it got switched up.
Yeah.
So I was like, oh,
dude.
Multiverse, let's get it. You know, that took forever to do.
Dude, that's
cool.
You hear me?
Y'all check our guy out.
Yeah,
for sure.
Look, so thank you. We're humbled. We're honored to have you on. We appreciate you. We appreciate your story. We appreciate you just being a humble human and just sharing with us. And your students are lucky as all get out to have you. I'm going to tell you right now, I'm definitely going to give you a follow, and I'm going to stay updated on what you're doing because I want to know.
Always on it, you know what I'm saying? That ain't never going to stop.
Man, thank you so very much for coming and sitting here with us at The Real PLC.
Enjoy, man.
Like I said, we're humbled, we're honored. I'm going to let Tupac come back into the fray. Ladies and gentlemen, the PLC is over. Make sure you sign the sign-out sheet. And we expect to see all this implemented in your classrooms.
Like
meeting dismissed. See ya.
Out of here.